Abu Dhabi is being redefined. Today, its non-oil sectors drive over half of its economic activity, marking a major shift from dependence to diversification over the past few decades. How did this transformation happen? And what opportunities does the UAE capital unlock for global investors and business leaders? In the Abu Dhabi Advantage series, we'll explore the strategies, sectors, and stakeholders shaping the future of Abu Dhabi. Welcome to the third episode of the Abu Dhabi Advantage series. Today, we're going to dive into the role that AI and advanced tech play in fueling Abu Dhabi's economic growth. AI isn't just transforming industries. It's redefining the way we work, live, and invest. Joining me today are two distinguished guests who are leading the way in this space. Jasem Alawadhi, who is the Acting Director General of Economic Affairs at the Abu Dhabi Department of Economic Development. Welcome.
Pleasure.
And Talal Al Kaissi, who is Group Chief Global Affairs Officer at G42 and also Chief Partnerships Officer at Core42. Welcome.
Thank you.
So let's get into it. Guys, tell me a little bit about why Abu Dhabi is so focused on AI.
I think to start, there are two parts to answering this question. When you look at the characteristics of AI, applying vast knowledge to defining problem statements and then speed of execution, these things, they go hand in hand with our ambition. In terms of why is it so crucial and important for economic strategy, it's for the endless potential of benefit that it can bring to the residents, businesses, as well as to the world. Where we are today in, you know, our economic development journey, we have more than 200 different nationalities, we have different universities, we've managed to attract the right talent, and we've created a highly productive ecosystem. With AI, you know, we can really push success to a new frontier, push innovation to a new frontier.
Talal, maybe you could introduce us to G42 and Core42, as these are key players in doing all the things that Jasem just mentioned.
Sure. And to Jasem's point, it's got the comparative and competitive advantages that would have attracted and created the right ingredients for a company like ours to be birthed in 2018, where we can contribute to a significant part of the AI value chain. So if you look at it in a couple of layers, you have physical infrastructure in the form of a company called Khazna that is providing the shell and core plus the design for the cloud and AI compute capabilities that will be required to enable artificial intelligence. Then there's Core42, which is a layer above that in terms of digital infrastructure, and that's where your servers and the cloud and the AI infrastructure layer fit in. Then you need the models and the AI solutions that would be developed. And that's where a company like Inception, which is our applied AI research institute, mm-hmm. is focused. And things like the Arabic language model, JACE, or an investment model and an energy model come out of that entity itself. And then you have operating businesses that are industrialized verticals where you're building applications and solutions. So you see things from Presight and big data analytics, AIQ, which is energy transformation, a joint venture initially with ADNOC and now part of Presight, M42 in the healthcare domain where we run things like the digital health initiatives such as the Emirati Genome Program and other areas of digital health as well, geospatial services in Space42 and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. So that's how we complete a significant portion of that AI value chain, leveraging what Abu Dhabi has to offer in comparative and competitive advantages.
So where do you see AI having impact today?
So I think AI is essentially something that is now helping us augment human ingenuity to unlock really insights out of huge amounts of data. Essentially, what you have is a data set that becomes a goldmine to big pharma companies or healthcare mm-hmm. providers to tap into to understand how they can derive insights to create things like drug discovery, precision medicine, preventative care, longevity research, all by leveraging that data set. Mm-hmm. and combining it with other data sets. And similarly, if in space, you have remote sensing data, which is very, you know, storage intensive, but also computationally intensive, to then also derive insights from, you know, optical imagery, radar imagery, combining them, and for a variety of different use cases, looking at land deformation, land subsidence, and things that can help with climate, precision climate modeling. All these things are part of what we're able to unlock the value of with massive amounts of data.
Jasem, government initiatives like Savvi and Awa are set to bring billions to the economy. Can you tell us a bit about how they came about?
In 2007, you know, it all started there with an Abu Dhabi economic diversification vision, where there was a decision not to rely on one source of, you know, growth or potential or resource. Since then, we have established so many different industries. With regards to Savvi and Awa, they're part of a you know, wider vision on an industrialization in Abu Dhabi, where we launched the Abu Dhabi Industrial Strategy a couple of years back. Savvi and Awa collectively, we're talking about contributing more than 50 billion in GDP by 2045. We're talking about creating more than, you know, 50,000 jobs.
Wow.
Directly. What's really different about Savvi and Awa are that they're economic clusters. Last year, we've launched the Smart and Autonomous Vehicle Industries cluster, right? Where we think about the activity related to manufacturing, you know, autonomous vehicles or vehicles, and we're thinking about the driverless experience.
Yeah, and that particular experience with driverless cars, we actually at G42, as part of a company called Space42, deploy the brain and the fleet of those autonomous vehicles. We look at the geospatial data and the high-definition mapping within the Bayanat Smart Solutions part of Space42, and then on the communications infrastructure from the Yasat Space Solutions component, are combining these technologies to be able to deliver that driverless experience and deploy the fleet that takes advantage of the cluster that Abu Dhabi has built.
Mm. You mentioned Awa. What does it do?
So the Agri Growth and Water Abundance cluster is where we really want to push the frontier with technology such as AI to solve, you know, global problems in terms of shortages of food, shortages of water, you know, help cut through with new innovative solutions for novel foods such as alternative proteins. And we want to do this here from Abu Dhabi. We have the state-of-the-art universities. We have the programs. We have the talents. And we have, simply speaking, the sophistication, right? Mm. So when you put ambition with this sort of soft and physical infrastructure, your possibilities are endless. The important element is, you know, these initiatives are orchestrated. They're not parachuted. They're part of a bigger plan, and they're no longer just for the Abu Dhabi economy, right? Now, when we talk about smart and autonomous vehicles, or we talk about, you know, food, alternative proteins, it's an economic development plan where we want to really contribute to the global demand and the global supply, help regions around the world unlock their potential with the help of Abu Dhabi.
I just read a report, Jasem, that 44% of businesses in MENA are struggling with AI and tech talent. So ambition, they have the ambition, but they don't have the talent to realize that ambition. What are you in the Abu Dhabi Emirate doing to attract this AI talent?
We have to really think about what do we mean by AI talent. The beauty of it, I think there's no one way to tackle the talent gap if it exists. I think the best way is that everybody starts using it. Everyone you meet in Abu Dhabi is probably using some sort of AI in their day-to-day life. Mm-hmm. I think this is, you know, 80% of solving the problem.
And I think a key part there is how upskilling and reskilling and then also learning from scratch in AI is also evolving as quickly, if not quicker, than the technology itself. And so when you look at institutions like the Mohammed bin Zayed University of Artificial Intelligence here in Abu Dhabi and the fact that they've just announced an undergraduate program, I think teaching AI and teaching people how to harness it is going to differ from having to look at things in terms of technical skills to understanding better what the technical components are able to deliver and figure out how the human interaction with that technical new intelligence form factor can do to unlock the most value for their particular use cases.
And just to add to what Talal is saying, I think experience matters in adopting new technology. And I think second, we have a relatively young demographic that, you know, is very tech savvy.
And so if talent isn't a barrier to scaling AI in Abu Dhabi, what is? What do you see as any challenges or gaps in scaling AI across various industries in Abu Dhabi?
So if you look at it on a global scale, yes, there are a lot of gaps. I mean, energy infrastructure is going to be critical. If you think about what AI requires to enable the diffusion of AI or the provision of equitable access for AI globally, beyond just building a foundation model, but deploying that foundation model and being able to have fine-tuned models for specific use cases, the infrastructure build-out on a global scale is massive, both from a CapEx and from a technical and execution standpoint. Mm-hmm. If you think of the world today, there's only about 60 gigawatts of data center capacity. And to diffuse AI, in our estimations, in a way that provides equitable access, you are going to need anywhere between 300 and 500 gigawatts of capacity.
Wow.
Now, if you break it down to a gigawatt level, is roughly around $45 billion a gigawatt. So if you do the math, it's trillions of dollars worth of investments. Abu Dhabi is so uniquely positioned when it comes to clean energy, whether it's nuclear or renewables, natural gas, to provide forcing function for companies that are interested in deploying this physical and digital infrastructure to capitalize on what's here, in addition to the connectivity, which is required as well to diffuse AI beyond Abu Dhabi. So it could be really the grand central of AI, mm-hmm. if you think about it. And that's where I think we're quite uniquely positioned. It's not something new to us. Nuclear facilities were something that were conceived of back in 2007. So the foresight that the visionary leadership in Abu Dhabi had is what's enabling us to capitalize on that momentum to enable and unlock the power of AI at scale.
Just to comment on what Talal was saying, I mean, one of the competitive advantages adding to, you know, the foresight of the leadership of the Emirate of Abu Dhabi is how close the private sector and government sector work, specifically when it comes to economic development. And, you know, I'm very interested in hearing Talal's view on, you know, what are the kind of partnerships that G42 can today leverage or nurture to sort of support the government in the years ahead, specifically when it comes to artificial intelligence.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think an important component to everything we do is using partners as a force multiplier to everything that we're trying to accomplish. So a great example of that is what we've done with Microsoft. Not only did they invest in G42, but even prior to that investment, we built a very unique partnership with them that I think is something that they even now think is exportable to other parts of the world in a joint value proposition with G42 to enable the Abu Dhabi government to leverage public cloud in a sovereign way and deliver value to public sector and regulated industries here in Abu Dhabi.
And you both mentioned the regulatory framework. Maybe you could tell us from your point of view, Talal, a bit more about the regulatory framework and how that enables the work that G42 does in AI.
Obviously, regulations are a key critical part of any type of industry to evolve and excel. The problem is where technology is evolving at a faster pace than regulations, sometimes the technologies have to fit existing regulations. And I think the uniqueness of Abu Dhabi's environment is that the regulations are adapting and evolving to ensure that they don't curtail innovation, and that the Abu Dhabi government and the regulators understand the imperatives around adopting AI. Mm-hmm. There was a recent announcement by Abu Dhabi to become the first digitally AI native government in the world. To be able to do that effectively, there needs to be a permissive regulatory framework, mm-hmm. that allows for, to a certain extent, sometimes even experimentation in new approaches to deploying technology. So there's always this fine line and balance between making sure that things are done in a safe manner, but also not suppressing the potential to unlock more innovation and value. And that's where I think Abu Dhabi excels.
I'm very happy to hear this answer coming from Talal, because one of the things, you know, we're super proud of, making sure that whatever is being developed is being developed in tandem with the need and the requirement, right? So we were pioneers and when it came to, you know, blockchain and regulation, and I think today, when it comes to regulation on AI, we're doing the same, right? So it's something at the heart of what we do, and I think why we're successful at it is because we stay super close to the stakeholder, right? So if you're regulating AI, you cannot do this today without having a conversation with Talal.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot do it without having conversations with companies who have skin in the game, employees who are using the tool, individuals who are impacted by it. Just to give you an example, with Savvi, when we launched the cluster, we brought all the stakeholders. So we had global companies. We brought local players who are on the receiving end. Mm-hmm. And we brought government entities at the UAE federal level and at the Abu Dhabi level to sort of incept on that day the creation of this cluster and make sure that now, as we regulate and the activity picks up, it happens in a parallel fashion.
And Jasem, I can't emphasize enough how important that feedback loop has been with the government for the private sector and industries and companies like G42. Effectively, what you're allowing us to do is really accelerate our path towards innovative new breakthroughs, by not curtailing innovation by inadvertently regulating something that would have made it harder to experiment and to prototype certain things that might be cutting edge. I mean, autonomous driving is one of many examples that you want to be able to lean forward. And that permissive regulatory framework and environment that Abu Dhabi affords us uniquely positions us, I think, on a global level to be able to capitalize on what Abu Dhabi has to offer and that forward-leaning approach that the government takes and that feedback mechanism that's afforded to us.
I just want to pick up on something that you said, Jasem. What is happening in Abu Dhabi on the R&D side?
A lot is happening in Abu Dhabi on research and development, whether it's, you know, thinking about how do we attract the right innovative talent and how do we place them in the right sectors that are witnessing disruptions, whether it's about thinking differently on, you know, patent, whether it's about thinking of new use cases that can create huge benefits in industries where we're already global champions. From a government perspective, what we try to do is create the platforms and help the ecosystem to work together.
Obviously, we lean on the institutions that are available over here, like the Mohammed bin Zayed University of Artificial Intelligence for fundamental AI research and for human capital talent pool as well.
And to both of you, if you had one message to the world on this topic of AI in Abu Dhabi, what would it be?
I think Abu Dhabi is like an open lab. And that open lab environment is very conducive to the best and the brightest minds and companies to come and leverage what it has to offer, to be able to build and innovate and iterate quickly and really take things to the next level in terms of the development plans that they have, and also leverage the compute infrastructure that we're deploying here at scale and the energy infrastructure that is enabling that. I think that it's a very unique confluence of the right ingredients, and that, along with the geographic centricity and the lifestyle that Abu Dhabi affords, is something that should be a real attraction to any company and any innovator around the world that wants to come and leverage what Abu Dhabi has to offer.
Jasem, do you agree?
I completely agree. And I think my message, or, you know, what I want to leave the audience with is, you know, simply speaking, we're your partners, right, at Abu Dhabi. I don't think in Abu Dhabi we're riding this wave, mm-hmm. right? I think we're building this wave. We're huge momentum behind AI. And years back, the United Arab Emirates bet on artificial intelligence. And, you know, we have guidelines and policies about artificial intelligence that have been out there for a long, long time. It's no longer an experimental technology. You know, it's something that it's out there. It's impacting day-to-day decisions and, you know, day-to-day behaviors.
Yeah, I can't agree more, Jasmine. I think it's the worst it will ever be as it stands today, which is an incredible thing to think about, but it's only going to get better from here.
Well, I've learned a lot from Talal and Jasem today. I've learned that AI is not the future. It's here now. And I've learned that Abu Dhabi is embracing AI not just for its own economic growth, but it wants to solve problems on a global stage. Thank you for joining me on this episode of the Abu Dhabi Advantage series, and I hope to see you next time.